So over the last couple of months, I've gotten a lot of emails from our viewers saying we've never addressed time travel on the show. Now, there's a number of reasons why maybe we just didn't get to that quite yet, but I thought, why don't we have on Lawrence Krauss? He's a theoretical physicist, also a cosmologist, professor of physics, and director of the Origins Project at Arizona State University. So let's start broad scope. What is the kind of a scientific view on the possibility of time travel as it's colloquially known right now?
Well, actually, the fact that you didn't have time travel, maybe one of the many proofs against time travel, because if had been able to time travel, you would have gone back in time and done the program already.
Right.
But in any case, we'll get to that. The scientific consensus, remarkably, is that we don't know. That clearly, time travel produces problems. In fact, when my book, The Physics of Star Trek, came out, it caused a big stir in England in particular, because Stephen Hawking had written the foreword for that book. And had come out previously saying time travel was impossible. But in the foreword of the book, he said, as I say in the book, that time travel may be possible given the laws of physics. It was the front page of the London Times, Stephen Hawking changes his views. Because he'd given this argument that if time travel were possible, we'd already be inundated by tourists from the future. And I countered him by saying that they all went back to the 1960s and no one noticed. So he had to agree. But it wasn't quite that. But the point was that time travel induces all these paradoxes. We live in a universe where causes produce effects. The causes always happen before the effects. But in fact, of course, if time travel is there, then causality goes out the window, or appears to. And so since causality is at the heart of physics, many physicists have assumed that the laws of physics should say that time travel is impossible. But, of course, you've got this problem Einstein's general relativity and special relativity, both of them, tie together space and time and put space and time in the same footing. And you can clearly do a circle in space, so why can't you do a circle in time? And in principle, in fact, in general relativity, it's possible. Given that fact, general relativity tells us that the geometry of the universe in space and time is determined by the configuration of energy and matter within that universe. So if you can mathematically write down a geometry which has closed time-like loops, if you want to call them that, or loops where you go back in time, if you can write down that geometry mathematically on the left-hand side of the equation, then there's an energy and density on the right-hand side that you can invent mathematically that will produce that. The key question and the open question is, can you physically produce that kind of energy in order to do that? And that's the open question. So are there laws of physics that forbid you from producing exactly the type of energy that would produce time travel? And that's the open question. People have shown, for example, situations with weird things called cosmic strings intersecting, that you could create such a geometry. But are there laws of physics that say you can't produce those configurations? And we don't know the answer. But if it's possible, we have to come to grips with these paradoxes, the most famous of which is the grandmother paradox, as I call it in my book. You can go back in time and kill your grandmother. If there's time travel, you can go back in time and kill your grandmother before your mother's born. But if that's the case, then your mother isn't born. But if your mother isn't born, then you're not born. If you're not born, how did you go back in time and kill your grandmother in the first place? It gives you a headache to think of those kind of things. And so clearly, obviously, if time travel is possible, it has to be in such a way that those kind of paradoxes don't happen, because we don't observe them. And so it must be more subtle.
So let me split.
Open question at the forefront of physics, but many people suspect that the laws of quantum mechanics and relativity ultimately combine together to say that you can't produce those configurations, but we just don't know for sure.
I've read about the possibility of so-called forward time travel, and that if you get up on a spaceship and you start circling the Earth fast enough, and it would take a while to get up to a speed at which you would start to observe this, there would be, I don't know if the right term is time dilation or compression or whatever the case may be, but that you might spend, say, 10 years circling the Earth really fast, and when you came back to Earth, you would be 10 years older, so to speak. But on Earth, maybe 12 years would have gone by, and you would have kind of, in practical terms, skipped forward 2 years. Is that different? And first of all, correct me if I'm way off on this, that explanation.
In fact, that's absolutely possible. But the point is, we all do forward time travel. We just did it. We began this interview, you know, 5 or 10 minutes ago, and we've now gone forward. So forward time travel is something we do without even trying. Now, what special relativity tells you is the rate at which you move forward in time depends upon your circumstances, and different observers will have clocks that tick at different rates, and therefore their measurements of time and their aging and everything else will happen at different rates. That happens. We measure that in laboratories all the time, every day in undergraduate physics laboratories around the world and at particle accelerators. Indeed, it would be true also if you traveled on a spaceship fast enough, close enough to the speed of light, that you could come back and everyone would have aged a lot more than you.
So
it happens.
So let's talk about that. Could that potentially be exploited? In other words, spending 10 years to move 12 years is not that big of a difference, but what if you could exploit that and scale it in a way?
Well, I mean, you could exploit it. You could, if you were going fast enough, 10 years for you would be 50,000 years on Earth.
Sure.
The problem is, to have that happen, you have to be going at 99.999999% the speed of light. And we can do that with elementary particles. That's what happens at the Large Hadron Collider in Geneva. We accelerate particles to 99.9999% the speed of light. And we have these effects happen all the time. But to send a human being to accelerate a spacecraft to that kind of speed would require more energy than there is in the, well, if you use conventional rocket fuel, more mass than there is in the entire visible universe as fuel. So that would be a problem. So the point is that it just is prohibitive to send macroscopic objects at large fractions of the speed of light. We could imagine accelerating an object over 3 years, say, with some kind of external source of energy to maybe half the speed of light, and that would be significant. But at that point, at half the speed of light, yeah, your clocks will be, you know, 5 or 10% faster than mine. So that's the case. But you know, that the kind of cost involved and time involved in doing that, probably the reason you do it is so you could go somewhere, not so you could, your clocks would change by 10%.
So last thing in the last minute or two we have left, much of the technology that today we kind of take for granted and seems like, yeah, we've had that for several years now, 400 years ago would have been seen like magic. So do you believe that if at some point there is so-called time travel, that it will be along the lines of what today is considered the primary conventional thought on time travel? Or will it be due to some kind of total paradigm shift in terms of technology or science?
No, you know, the point is, when you say that, it gives a false impression. It's true that much of what appears today would be magic 400 years ago. So there's lots we don't understand about the world. But what's really important is the stuff we understand isn't going to be thrown out.
Hmm.
So you're not going to suddenly be able to change things so balls fall up. And you know, even though we've overturned the laws of physics since Newton, you throw a ball, it's still described by Newton's laws. And so there's many, many constraints that we have now that are never going to change because they're based on experimental physics, experimental results. And so whatever we learn at the forefront of physics, it's not going to suddenly change and say, hey, guess what? Suddenly you can do things now that were literally impossible before. Namely, literally, you could test and they didn't work before. Nature isn't going to change that way. So if we're going to do time travel or something like it, it's going to be by playing at the very edges of physics in extreme regions. And you're right, if it were possible, it would require physics we don't understand. But it's not going to overturn what we now have already disproved fundamentally. And by the way, here's one of the biggest things about time travel that is never recognized. We also do space travel. We tend to think we're standing still, but we're not. We're going 30 kilometers per second around the sun. So if H.G. Wells went in his time machine and went back a minute, he'd be 1,800 kilometers. Well, if he went back an hour, he'd be out in space. He'd be dead because the Earth would have moved away on its orbit.
But his machine accounted for that.
Did it?
I have no idea. I don't know.
No, well, if he did, it's not written in the book. You'd have to account for it somehow. You'd also have to have a propulsion system that kept track of where the Earth was.
Because, right.
You know, a few minutes later, you're going to find yourself out in space, and wouldn't be very pleasant to suddenly reappear out in empty space.
I'm pretty sure Radio Shack sells the adapter you need for that.
Yeah, it could be just like the Heisenberg compensators in Star Trek for the transporter. But we won't go into that.
All right, Lawrence Krauss, theoretical physicist, cosmologist, professor of physics, director of the Origins Project at Arizona State University. Thanks so much for being here. This was great.
It's great. Thanks a lot. You take care.